I have pushed the record button. Everything that goes on from here on is on the record. Are you guys ready?
No, but we'll do it anyway.
I could never get Bill to shut up. Ham Radio Now, episode 160, the Friday night BS on Wednesday night, because that's when we could do it. And I've got I've doubled the size of the panel. I've got Ward Silver N0AX is joining Bill Pasternack, WA6ITF. Gentlemen, welcome to Ham Radio Now.
That's right. I want to be Charlie Weaver.
Who is Charlie Weaver?
He doesn't know who Charlie Weaver is.
Hollywood Squares
thing. Charlie?
Charlie, he didn't go for the block with Marty in the middle. Okay, let's see what happens.
She went for the bubble instead of the block.
maybe Paul Lynde. I'll go for Paul Lynde.
Yeah, okay. Hollywood Squares, I haven't watched that in a million years. Ward, there's
off the air for a million years.
there's something I need to show you here, Ward. You have written a dummies book, right?
I have.
So we did a show on that not too long ago, and I have written a dummies book.
Oh. Excellent.
Because I'd been off the air for like 3 weeks after I came back from Dayton, and I needed a refresher. So unfortunately, I had written this some time ago. Mine is a little thicker than yours.
Yeah, that's true.
And the cover is also bigger than the rest of the book.
A little bit of a Potemkin village there, but yeah, we'll take it.
Yeah. So anyway, I got to start my stopwatch so I know when we've talked too long, and then we'll keep on going. So I got a few subjects to talk about, and we will get to all of them in due course if we can get that far. But the first thing I want to show everybody is this. Ta-da!
Yippee!
Now, there's still 27 hours to go. We are $405 over the goal. There's a few folks that have a $500 commitment all in one little bundle. If any of those guys pull out, we will fall short. So I'm just, you know, I'm kind of sweating the next 27 hours. And there's still a possibility that one of the big backers, a $2,000 level, could still get picked up by anybody who's got 2,000 bucks and wants a serious underwriting in the program. This program will almost certainly not be online before that time expires, because we're going to finish this up somewhere a little about 10 o'clock. A client sent me a job to do tonight, and I needed to be in a studio tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock for an all-day session and all-day Friday. So I'm probably not getting this online till the weekend, and I will know for sure if the Kickstarter has been successful and just how successful it's been. But it looks pretty much like I'm going to Austin. So, good deal. Either of you guys been to a DCC ever?
Digital Communications Conference? Yeah.
Yeah.
I had one in a couple of them in Illinois. And I went to the Microsoft conference out in Seattle once. All good. Very thought-provoking.
Yeah.
Neat guys doing neat stuff.
We were probably at the one together in Chicago. They did it 2 years in a row, 2008, 2009, and I shot those.
Yep.
And now I feel bad because you mentioned the Microsoft conference, and those guys gave me a hard drive with the conference from last year, 2 years ago, and said, if you ever get time to edit it. And I went, but I took the drive. And so, you know, Maybe someday I'm sure there's some worthwhile stuff on there.
That guilt is a powerful thing.
it has almost never managed to overcome my time deficit, unfortunately. So we do have a few more things to talk about. We were hoping that Rich Moseson would be able to join us, and unfortunately he is not able to come tonight. So we'll try to get him pigeonholed on a program sometime soon. I'm impressed, Bill, that we're on BS number two.
Yeah, BS number one was a heck of a lot of fun.
Yeah, yeah, and it was pretty popular. It's not the most watched show that we've ever done, but I'm sort of coming to the philosophy that, I mean, if you look across a magazine like UST, CQ, there's the construction stuff and the stuff that most hams are interested in, and that's typically upfront. And then there's the what would you call it? The wonky stuff, the policy, the public service, the doing the business of ham radio, that's toward the back. I belong in the back of the book. I think that's my home. I'll do, you know, technical shows now and then with all the Tapper. The Tapper stuff should fill up my quota of technical for the year, because there'll be like 25 shows out of that. But no one else is doing this sort of media on those subjects, you know, this kind of a show where we're just talking about what's going on, but not building a kit, not burning any solder. That probably gives you some heartburn, Ward, because you're the construction guy.
Ham radio is big. There's a lot of stuff below the water. It takes all kinds. It takes tinkerers, solderers, political guys, organizers, managers, you know, what have you. They all are in there in the bucket together.
Okay. You're being kind to me. In any case, I kind of feel the need for doing this kind of a show. And I'm going to just sort of accept the idea that it's never going to be the most popular thing. So
it doesn't have to be, because, you know, it's very topical, and 6 months from now, it's not going to be topical. So it's what it is, and it's what it's for.
Yeah. I mean, you don't burn any solder on Newsline either, so.
You'd be surprised. ever take a Linear Tech mixer apart?
Well, I'm talking about in the show, not for the show.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I've had to do a fair amount of technical stuff just to get this going, and it's not as good as I want it to be.
Walk back and forth several times, and then you can get him on the kitty video channels. And
well, yeah, one night we got to have a show based on our pets.
Yeah, I should have a cat wandering around here before the show is over. There should be somebody coming by here. Well, I wanted to give a hat tip to the ARRL. They just concluded their very successful centennial convention. I've seen a variety of attendance numbers. They were looking 4,000 to 5,000 or so. I think the final number that I saw is fairly officially from the league was about 3,000. And 3,000 is still a pretty good size ham fest. Most ham fests would kill to have 3,000 people coming these days.
I think there are probably a lot of uncounted, unregistered people in a cloud around the event as well. So you had a lot of people in the Newington area having a good time.
Do you think that they will get the idea to do this again in less than 100 years?
Well, I'm planning on being here for the next one. I'll let you know.
me too.
Yeah, there you go. Having a regular sort of a meet and celebrate our existence kind of a show is a good thing, maybe every 20 years, every 25 years, something like that. And it's a lot of fun. It's an opportunity to look back and look forward and celebrate a little history, celebrate your accomplishments. Sure, why not? I don't think anybody who was in charge of organizing it wants to think about that kind of thing. It's a big job. But let's give them a few years to see what happens.
There is one thing that I'm kind of disappointed in, and that is that, as far as I know, nothing was recorded on video and nothing went online. I would really love to see the Craig Fugate keynote at the banquet and some of the other talks. And there had been a rumor. Somebody said there's a rumor going around that I recorded it, and I wasn't there, and you guys weren't there. So all we have is just little snippets of what these guys did.
You know, yeah. I would suggest waiting a couple of weeks and just see what turns up by itself on YouTube or Vimeo. You never know who had a camera with them.
Did anybody record anything of those addresses for Newsline, Bill?
No, I don't have anything. We didn't have anybody there, so it's the same. It's the same thing at. You're saying, as far as I know, there was no video done. But I would wonder why, because if this was an event of this magnitude, you'd think that the league, which has its own now in-house video department, would want to put some of this stuff on, I wouldn't say tape, but on bits and bytes, you know?
Do they have their own in-house video department?
Yeah, basically they have their own equipment. As a matter of fact, when we did DIY show, which you were involved in, Alan Pitts was tagged was along at several one or two locations. I forget which ones, but he was shooting also with a Panasonic prosumer level camera that the Leak had bought. So they do have equipment. Whether they used it or not, I don't know.
Yeah, we're all using prosumer level equipment. Go ahead, Ward.
John Kutzko is the PR guy these days, and he's more or less in charge of that equipment. And you know, he was busy actually being part of the event and couldn't extract himself to be out of the event and recording it. So I think they just ran out of people more than anything else.
Yeah, and that's sort of my one of my things about media and the PR guys. And by the way, I believe we're all PIOs.
I'm not
a PIO.
Well, you've been involved in the PR end of things. You're on the PR reflector. Mm-hmm. And get stuff going, paying attention to what ARL does in PR. And, right. And one of my things about that is that in terms of, there's a cattail that went by there. Ward.
Wow.
One of the things about that is that in any kind of an emergency situation, if your group, your Aries group is involved in that, public relations is a full-time job. It needs somebody to be doing that, and it needs that person to not be also doing a bunch of other things, or it won't get done right. So that's my opinion of it,
if I may interject, which I will, this is one of the things we tried a couple of years ago to form the amateur radio video corps, or whatever it was, that would be somebody from each club who would just do one thing. Take the video camera, go out and shoot the event, and couldn't get anybody, any place in the country. We tried, the league was with us on this, and it just didn't pan out. I think it comes down to hams are just not interested in being videographers, and professional videographers are kind of expensive to hire, as you know, and Ward's probably aware. You know, you're looking at $500-$700 a day minimum. So,
yeah, if you
that's
can't,
the problem.
You can't get a volunteer to do it.
Well, they want to do ham radio. You know, they're out busy. You talk to your typical ARES manager, and he's crying for operators and people to actually do the job, and getting somebody who's willing to dedicate themselves to the PIO function within the group is actually unusual. It's a part of the ICS structure that you have a public relations function, but being able to dedicate a knowledgeable, experienced person to that function is kind of rare. You need those people to be doing stuff most of the time.
Yeah, if you've got a limited number of people to do all the jobs, yeah, that may be fairly low on priority, but it is an important thing to get done. It's for the sake of the hobby and service.
Yeah, I think that's part of the message that gets out. You know, if you have, everybody has small cameras now. They don't have the quality stuff that's not omnipresent. But you have your phone or your point and shoot, and you can take a little video with it, and then after the fact. Maybe put it together. But nevertheless, you've got people that are trying to actually do whatever service it is that they're engaged to do. It'd be nice to encourage them to stop every once in a while, take a little video, do a little reportage, and then go back to whatever they were doing. Having a PIO officer there, for example, having a PIO officer dedicated to the job, I wish there were enough people that we could do that.
Yeah, I guess I wish there were enough people that we could do everything that we need to do. One of the things that's going on around here, and I imagine just about every place, is that we are getting, our local club gets involved in the bike-a-thons and walk-a-thons and marathons and every other thon, providing communications. And we're getting quite the reputation for being able to do that sort of thing. So more and more people are asking, well, fewer and fewer hams are volunteering to participate in doing it. So they're doing more and more with fewer and fewer. And that is another sad commentary on the nature of what people are doing in ham radio. And Bill is showing us how to shoot video. What have you got there?
This is Canon HS. It's a prosumer level Canon. And this is, we have two of them, my partner and I. These are the ones we use to shoot the DIY magic of amateur radio. Most of it was done with two of these. They're about $1,000, about $1,000. We got a, by buying two of them, we got a much better price. But they're not available. It's a prosumer camera. Very, very small. It's got every convenience you could want on it, and it works.
Well, as you know, that even today with just the camera that's sitting in your phone, you know, a camera that is in my phone like this is better than what a TV station had 15 years ago.
Better than what we had in news 10 years ago. Seriously.
Yeah. So you've got the capabilities to do good stuff, and I wish that you would do more of it. For Bill, for Newsline, for me, for ARRL, for everybody, your local your club activities, we do a really poor job of promoting ourselves and getting the word out. And we've been moaning about this ever since I've been involved in the ARRL PR committee more than 15 years ago. And I don't really see it getting better, even though the tools are getting easier and better, more available.
Yeah, even the cheapest smartphone with a built-in camera gets you amazing video. If you remember the video of the, I think it was the crash up in of the 777 up in San Francisco. I think that was caught by somebody on an iPhone or something like that.
Yep, I do have one tip. If you're going to shoot video with your phone, hold your phone like this.
Yes.
Not like this.
We don't want vertical video.
Although there's something compelling about that, even though it's wasting all that space. And I like to tell people, can I rent that space from you if you're not doing anything with it? There's something compelling about seeing pictures oriented that way. Maybe it's because for now they're different. They won't be different for long. Pretty soon CBS is going to start doing it that way because they look at the audience and say, that's what the audience wants.
But they do. Yeah.
Going to have to turn our monitor sideways.
There's actually a what we call PSA, public service announcement, somebody put together using some Muppets. And I don't know if you've seen it. It's on the web. And it's a rant against vertical video.
This video didn't have to look this way. It could have been prevented. Say no to vertical videos.
Vertical videos happen when you hold your camera the wrong way. Your video will end up looking like crap.
Well, it's just us professionals, I think, that worry about it, because I don't think the public cares or even is hardly aware of it.
Yeah, they'll say, what do you mean, vertical?
Yeah.
It's video, right?
They don't know.
Well, it drives me crazy.
Where I was going with this was that the ARRL could not dedicate anyone, apparently, to documenting some of the really important stuff, albeit the wonkier stuff that went on up at the convention. So,
well, we don't know. We won't know probably.
Well, if
something shows up on their website or something. But as far as I know, no. I just don't know, and I hesitate to guess because I know they have the equipment.
Yeah, if they're working on my timetable, it'll be 6 months before it comes out, because sometimes it takes me forever to get stuff going. But in any case, congratulations to the league on 100 years and a successful convention. And like I say, maybe we will see something happen up there in Hartford more frequently than every 100 years. I don't know if they did anything at 50. I was just becoming a ham back then.
Big 50 at the convention and the 75 too, I think. So yeah.
You were around back then, Bill, right?
Yeah. I remember the 75th. I think it was the 75th. I don't remember the 50th because I got licensed in 1959, but I was, you know, young kid, on 6 meter AM with my AREC, not AREC, but AREC yeah. group, and Racy's, of course.
You were still in New York, and it would have been 1964, right?
Yeah. Something. Well, I was licensed in 59.
Yeah, but 64 would have been their 50th.
Right.
And that was.
I know there was a convention, but I was not there.
Yeah, and I'm about to become a 50-year ham. That'll happen next January. Be my 50. So I was just becoming a ham, and although I read QST, and that's one of the things that absolutely got me fascinated about ham radio, because my mentor at the time, before I got licensed, was had the usual stack of QSTs in his shack, and I'd go over there, and we'd play radio a little bit, and he'd play radio, and I would sit there reading QST. So, like people still do today. So anyway, congratulations, guys. Let us move on. And the next topic is HR 4969. Can the news get any bigger? Bill, this is a pretty big deal.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, it's our lead story this week on our newscast that's coming up tomorrow night, as a matter of fact. And basically, it's that the league is being quite successful in getting co-sponsors. ARL Hudson Division Director Mike Lysenko posted on Facebook yesterday that they had picked up two new co-sponsors for the bill. Didn't say who it was, but yeah, that's the act. And but the other side of this is, and I know we'll get into this, is what's the opposition going to be? I mean, that's as important as getting co-sponsors.
Yeah, let's. In fact, what I'd like to do first is talk a little history, and some of the details about it. In fact, let's go over here and look at the most cogent detail, which is exactly what this is. This this page here that I'm looking at is the actual bill. It's in the House of Representatives, and there's only three pages. It's pretty short, I guess. By legislative standards, I'm not sure what the average bill length is, but I sort of think that they're longer than this. And all of the real important stuff is in this last little bit. The FCC shall amend Section 97.15B so that section, which currently holds PRB1, which does this for municipalities, which says your state and local government has to provide reasonable accommodation to your antennas. So now what they're proposing was that section will also prohibit the application of the amateur radio service of any private land use restriction. Anything that precludes communications, fails to reasonably accommodate such communications, or does not constitute the minimum practicable restriction on such communications to accomplishment the little bit legitimate purpose of the private entity seeking to enforce such restriction. I should have edited that a little bit before I read on.
That's very specific. That's a very specific wording that means very specific things.
Yeah. I did a show.
I did a show
with Fred Hopengarten, the attorney for Fred, yeah, for a bunch of hams, and he was quite bullish on the idea that the language in PRB1 for your municipality is pretty ironclad. To me, it's a tell it to the judge thing. To him, he wants to be the guy telling it to the judge. He thinks he will succeed more often than not. So, so what this does is then it applies it to the private contracts, the deeds that we have if we own homes, the homeowners associations if we're in such a location. A couple years ago, the ARL had been banging on the FCC to extend PRB1 to this stuff, this homeowners associations. And the FCC continually declined to do it. And finally they said, look, we're not going to do this. If you want this, go where the legislation happens, go to Congress. And so the ARL did. And I'm not sure I've got all of the timeline in perfect order, so you guys can correct me if I'm going astray. Congress said, we'll tell you what, FCC, do a study and tell us what the hams really need. Last year, or was it the year before? The FCC.
Who was last year?
The FCC did the study and essentially said, and I may be reducing this just a little bit too much, you don't need it. The hams don't need this private land use restriction relief because it's not that big a problem. I'm not sure where they got that idea. It sounded pretty political to me because the league collected a lot of information. Ham sent them a lot of information, probably not nearly as much as what it they should have gotten. You know, they got less than 1,000 comments, and they probably should have gotten thousands and thousands of comments. I'm not sure how many the ARL collected that didn't go directly to the FCC. But just doing a sample reading, they all said, we got trouble. You know, trouble in River City. Mm-hmm. With a capital T, and that stands for towers. So where the FCC got the idea that it wasn't a big deal, I don't know. So they sent the report back to Congress, and Congress now has a bill that says, we're ignoring the FCC, and we're proposing this, and here we go. So what happened at the FCC, and what happened to Congress?
Well, I don't think... you can say that the FCC, that the ARL is ignoring, the ARL is not ignoring the FCC. FCC says we need direction, so who gives the FCC direction? Congress. So what's your logical next step? You go to Congress.
Yeah.
That's exactly right. The FCC is not going to act to preempt private contracts. Without a very strong direction from Congress, and they're not going to do it on their own. This is, question has been put to the FCC ever since ERB1 came out, and they said we are not going there without a strong direction from the legislators, because the FCC just arbitrarily inserted itself into thousands and thousands and millions of private land use contracts on behalf of a fairly small group of obscure individuals, no matter how important we are, there would just be, let's see, an imbroglio, a contretemps, a giant uproar.
Hell to pay.
And they're just not going there. And so they'll say, look, if Congress directs us to do this and gives us some political cover, then we're going to do it. But we're not going to do it and then have Congress come back and beat us about the head and shoulders for overstepping our authority. So this is the only way to attack this problem is through the legislative process.
Well, where I was going was not that the ARL was ignoring what the FCC said. It's that Congress would be. If FCC told Congress, which they did, the hams don't have that big a problem with codes, covenants, and restrictions, and Congress is coming back with a bill that says, give them relief anyway. That's kind of like Congress is saying, well, thanks for the report, but we're not paying attention to it.
Gary, it's more, in my view, it's more the ARL is saying the report is wrong, and please give us relief.
Well, yeah, and I would agree. I think the report was wrong. It's just, I don't know if I'm surprised that this bill came up as quickly as it did without more. I was going to say without more effort. And that's not going to be right because a lot of work behind the scenes.
It's just in the co-sponsoring phase. This is the freebie part of legislation where lots of things get put into bills and they get circulated and you get some co-sponsors and then it goes in a committee and the closed doors close. And then it never comes out. There's lots and lots and lots of bills. And we've had several that apply to amateur radio that took several iterations through that process of going through the co-sponsorship. And then they would go into committee and then there'd be some problem with it. And it wouldn't make it this session, but we're going to reintroduce it next session. And this happens at the state level and local level and all sorts of things. We should be prepared. This is a long-term issue, and it's going to get the attention of the real estate people and the development people and all sorts of other people that may not be on our side, and there's going to have to be some negotiation. But, you know, it's a start. Let's see.
Yeah, there'll
be.
There'll be no way to keep this quiet, so that anybody who opposes it doesn't know it's happening. It's going to be very public.
Well, as I said, I was about to say, politics is a give and take situation. There's no black and white in politics. It's all a gray area, and you come in with this, and somebody else says no, I want that, and you get together, and that's what all these committees are about, and then you hope that something will come out of it. And if it does, maybe it'll make it to the floor of Congress. Besides which, right now, there's no bill in the Senate. So all you have now is a House measure with no comparable Senate measure.
I was going to toss out the question, does this have a snowball's chance, no matter how long, until I started seeing the tweets come in from the ARL today that President Kay Craigie and a delegation of league dignitaries has been prowling the halls of Congress. And as you said, Bill, they have come up with some more co-sponsors and visiting a lot of people. What they asked was hams to write to their legislators, their Congress people and senators, and representatives and senators. I know how Congress works. But instead of sending them directly to the representatives and senators, send them to the league, and with two purposes. One, it bypasses some of the mail routing that has to happen because of the possibility of bad stuff coming through the mail. It all gets very carefully inspected and can take a long time to actually reach where it's going. But two, just exactly what they're talking about doing today and yesterday, which is visiting the representatives and getting a chance for some one-on-one FaceTime and talk to them about it, and I guess get some co-sponsors. So I was thinking that was kind of a nice pat on the head kind of move, but it appears to be actually happening.
Yeah, and I'm not surprised. I think it's been done before during the interference from over power line and
BPL.
BPL, yeah, and it was not 100% successful, but it did alert a lot of the lawmakers to this. So there was no action really ever developed out of it, but it was very, very good public relations from the ARL to its members, and they really tried hard. I know because you and I were both involved in the video that Dave Bell and Al Cole and all of us put together on BPL and warning not only the ham radio public but the public at large that hey, yeah, it may be cheap, it may work, but it's going to be a problem in the long run, and so. You don't always win. I think that's the bottom line, but you have to represent your constituency. And that's what the league is doing today. And I think it was started yesterday, today. And whatever they're doing, they have to do. And I wish them all the best. Whether or not the long term on this is positive or negative, we're not going to know until the long term itself.
Yeah. Ward, you're saying that this is going to take a while.
Well, yeah, and I think I should point out that I'm not ARL staff. I'm an independent person. So basically, these are just my opinions. I work closely with the league, but what I say is not league policy or any kind of league official. I think it's useful to go to Washington, talk with people, get some interaction with them, alert them to the issues that we face. This bill that's out there, well, fine. I think you have to keep trying that. Even if you know it's kind of a placeholder, a lot of issues have had to go through Congress 2, 3, 4 times before there was enough consensus to, and all the the conflicts and compromises had to be worked out and put into the bill, and everybody had to get their say. And that took several sessions of Congress. And that was when Congress was actually functional. right now, they can't do anything. So, you know, what are they going to do? Anyway.
This week, they're actually getting a few things done.
I think they're going on vacation.
Yeah. They leave Thursday.
Be that as it may. This is going to take some time. We're going to have to make our case. We're going to have to educate a lot of people on the issues. We're going to have to listen to a lot of people with their concerns about preempting, adding this federal requirement to private contracts. Is there an alternative to legislation? Is there an alternative to FCC regulation? How can we do this? Perhaps it would be easier to provide hams with the tools, the legal tools, to work with homeowners associations and CCRs in order to get waivers for specific purposes that are not quite so threatening to the homeowner association structure and neighbors and developers. There, oftentimes you think, I'm going to do A, but when you try to do A, you find out it's really a lot easier to do B and actually get somewhere. But you got to try to do A first, and that's what the ARL is doing. I think it's great that they're in Washington. That's one of the places where our dues should be going, representing us. Now, whether we get 4969 through Congress this session is an open question, but I think the important thing is that the issue is starting to come up in front of representatives, so that they can consider that along with all the other thousands of things that they have to balance and weigh and deal with.
Yeah, I'm getting the impression that if you were a wagering man, your money would not be on anything this year.
The first year a bill goes through Congress like this that involves all these moving pieces, I think it'd be very, very difficult. I think you'd have to have some public crisis to hang this on for people to actually want to push it through. And frankly, we don't have a crisis right now. We haven't had a Hurricane Sandy or three or four big hurricanes down in Florida or Yellowstone erupting in a giant magma chamber, you know, or something like that. And so it's going to be a conversation piece this year, I think, realistically. Go ahead, write your congressman, send it to the ARL. Let's get it out in front of them. Let's see where it goes.
Yeah, and not just now, but it's going to go on for a while.
And next year, and the year and the year after that.
So, Bill, you were introducing a little while ago the concept of who's going to be opposed to this. One constituency that appears to be opposed to it is a fairly significant group of hams.
Yeah, I've been reading, and I also watched your program that you produced with, I don't know how many hams. I've tried to follow it, but it's really doesn't seem to be more than I use the word a large handful. And I have to also remember, you have to keep this in mind, that the league, there are what, three, I forgot the number of hams in the United States, but not all of them.
A little over 700,000, I think.
Yeah, 700,000. How many of those people really know what's happening? I mean, you have to be honest. How many people in the ham radio community, if there was a way to poll them, how many would really know, and of that number, how many would really be affected by it to a point where they want to get involved, either politically or financially? So this is something you have to keep in mind. You know, how big is the audience? What are the demographics? And I don't think anybody really knows that. But let's say there are hams opposed to it. You know, there's people who oppose everything. I live under CCNRs. I cannot have outdoor antennas. And as a matter of fact, when I first moved in here, and I'm here over 30 years now, and there was a rule against having any form of two-way radio within the complex. And that went away when, I think I told you the story last time. I caught somebody with a cell phone and told them, well, you got a radio. And they wouldn't believe me. And I said, well, how are you making your phone call? And it was like, oh. And that I don't know if it's still in the CCNRs, but that has not been enforced.
Yeah. Well, people don't know what radio really is anymore. So they don't realize their phones are radio.
Is the term now.
Yeah.
Wireless.
Yeah. Which, you know, we called ourselves wireless back in the day, and then that seemed old and quaint.
And I like to use the term extreme wireless.
Yeah.
That's a good one. So don't get your undies in a big bunch this year. Don't expect anything right away. Don't build your antenna and get the crew ready to put it up. That's probably not going to happen this year.
Journey of a thousand miles. Yeah.
I think the biggest concern are the homeowners association and associations, the association that represents homeowners and the associations that represent city planning or neighborhood planning and the builders. The builders want a perfect neighborhood, perfectly landscaped to sell houses. So you're going to have those three groups are going to be your biggest challenge. How do you get around them? And they have money. They are moneyed organizations.
Yeah, I think people look back to the OTARD, over-the-air receiving device preemption, as an example. But I caution them, the big money was in favor of that when that went through. And right now, the big money will be on the other side of the table opposing changes. So we have to work with that dynamic as opposed to having the big money wanting to push this through.
Do we have any kind of advantage in a certain level of obscurity that we just don't have very much of a profile? I mean, it hurts us in that we don't have any clout, but does it help us in that we're just not going to get much attention paid to it no matter what?
What would we do with clout? this is a hobby of individuals. A lot of our robustness, our ability to do what we do relies on the individual that is self-organizing into structures that are appropriate to meet whatever need arises. We're not really a big politically cloudy type group. We're not trying to sell something. We're not trying to acquire a market. It comes down to individuals. And I think your neighbors know you, your councilmen know you, your homeowner association knows you. That's the kind of clout that we really need to get what we want, which is personal accommodation. And I think it's sort of like the old saying about we're like ants at a picnic. You may get a few of us, but you know we're still going to get in the cake and the watermelon. You know, there's just a lot of us. And that happens on an individual basis, not so much on a giant national organizational basis. If the national organization can create an opening for us to work with, I think that's very good. But I don't think we can expect, as a relatively small group, to get some giant thing from the sky that says, all right, homeowners associations, thou shalt not. And I don't think that's going to really happen. But we can open up some avenues to work with on a personal basis where we can really show what we do that's appropriate to the communities in which we live.
Yeah. One of the things that the fellow I was talking to, Mike Alexander, was suggesting was to not preempt the existing homeowners associations and their codes and covenants, but to start a grandfathered program for that. And then going forward, anything newly created would have to respect our rights to have, or our privileges to have antennas put up, to do the reasonable accommodation thing. That may be one form of compromise that might actually get through someplace.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, you have to talk to the builders. They say, okay, look, all right, guys, you don't want everything that you've got preempted. How do we go forward? We've got a reasonable need. You've got some reasonable concerns. Where can we meet in the middle and see what comes out?
There's one thing that may be working on our side. more than usual, and that is that the chairman of the committee that is going to be handling this for the somewhere several layers deep in the House of Representatives is Greg Walden, who is a ham, the only ham in Congress. I used the stuff on their website to request an interview. Now, with this week being the last week that they're doing business before they all go home to fundraise, is probably not a good week to request an interview, but I did anyway. But I didn't hear anything back. Not too surprising. But that gives me the opportunity to talk about him and what he might be able to do without inappropriately not giving him the opportunity to participate in that discussion. Hopefully someday, you know, he'll say, little ham radio program. Well, it's not CNN, it's not Fox News, but I'm a ham. I can make 15 minutes available for a little ham radio show.
A guy like Greg Wyden, who's knowledgeable, can serve a very valuable function as an arbitrator between the various interest groups that come to the table to discuss this. And you don't have to educate the legislator in this point. You have a knowledgeable guy who's already participating. He understands the terms. He understands the stakes and can work with all of the parties to find an acceptable middle ground. And maybe whatever that turns out to be, let's see. Let's raise the issue. Let's raise our profile a little bit. Do some personal, all politics is local, do some personal contact and see where we can get. I know, for example, my state rep here had absolutely no idea that there were restrictions on amateur radio antennas or that we were even federally licensed as far as she was concerned. And she was by no means ignorant or anything. She just simply didn't know who we were until somebody in her group took her aside and said, hey, look, here's the deal. Here's what I do. Here's my circumstances, and these are the issues that I have. She had no idea. So having a knowledgeable legislator to guide us through this process and is skilled at the art of the possible would be a very valuable thing to have on our side.
Do you think that he is precluded from taking much of a strong position, either by propriety or just plain old wisdom? He's a ham, so we're going to have hams who are saying he's got to be on our side, right?
Well, not necessarily.
You always got guys saying, he's one of us, and then you find out everybody on all sides is saying, he's one of us.
One of us.
We have no idea what else he has on his plate, what his background is. I don't know him personally. I just know that he's familiar with our issues and can serve as a knowledgeable arbitrator between conflicting interests, and that's what politics is all about.
And we don't.
The other side of this, Gary, is that because he is a licensed amateur, he might be forced to recuse himself from being involved in this. We don't know. We don't know what Mr. Walden's what the position he's going to be in. We just have to wait and see.
Yeah, I hadn't thought about.
He may have to recuse himself from votes and procedural issues.
Exactly.
He can still be involved in the discussions and be a very valuable resource to whoever is involved.
Yeah, a ham license, of course, carries no financial benefit. It's not that there's no financial attachments to it.
It carries a financial implication, usually negative.
Yeah.
It's a hobby.
Yeah. So, they may have a bearing on whether or not he can actually vote and do stuff like that. They'll figure all that stuff out. Normally, ham radio is fairly immune to partisan politics, but the hams that I'm finding are opposed to this bill, against their own apparent self-interest, but still holding firm to their convictions, are generally either conservative or libertarian, the folks that say the federal government should stay hands off. That's kind of an unusual partisan divide within ham radio and kind of an awkward position for some hams who, because I get the impression that at least the hams who are vocal, the ones that make a lot of noise, those guys are pretty conservative. You don't hear liberals talking on the radio very much. You hear conservatives spouting off all the time on ham radio. And those guys are going to have to look twice at where this issue, where they come down on this issue, because it tends to, you know, kind of push against the philosophy that generally they're going to be holding. Although I think, as in general, we can say that when someone's own personal ox is gored, sometimes they take a little different position.
Well, it's kind of funny. I've seen some guys who are staunch anti-government people still, and then suddenly are in favor of this bill, but then they'll turn around on the next email and they'll say something, you know, that's completely contradictory to it. I haven't quite figured it out. I understand the position. They don't want any more federal regulation, and that's why the FCC will not do this on their own without strong political cover and a clear benefit to the public direction from Congress. They're just simply not going to go there. There's no political will to have a federal regulatory agency like the FCC suddenly insert itself into millions of private land use contracts. I mean,
exactly.
Would you whack that hornet's nest? You know, you're just not going to do it. So there has to be a discussion. We have to go through this legislative process to find out what the issues are, what are the acceptable ways for the private and public sector to go forward to work out this issue. And is this issue really important enough for everybody to spend time and resources discussing and resolving? Well, we'll find out.
We will.
Definitely we will. And probably not this session of Congress, and maybe not next session of Congress, but down the line.
Yeah, I mean, to me, this is one of the most important things that's come down the pike in a long time. And although there are, everybody takes the position, if they oppose it, that it doesn't affect very many people. So, why are we even bothering? Because they want to set up that straw man. But I think almost all of us have somewhere between personal experience or one step away from someone who's got personal experience that has either not been able to put up an antenna or been told to take one down or had trouble finding a house to buy in a neighborhood they wanted to be in because just not going to be compatible with a hobby that was very important to them. So I think it's real important, and I think it's going to affect a lot of people. So, well, we'll see.
I agree. It's a very important issue. The only more important issue facing amateur radio right now is outreach to people younger than us.
Okay, I'll say that. Yes.
Yeah, you know, that's the big issue in the next 20 to 50 years. But you still have to be able to put up an antenna to communicate, and that's an important part of the hobby. And maybe there'll, you know, be some instance of amateur radio showing its value to the public in a large way, and that'll help us make our case.
There's a ham named Tony who is kicking himself as he watches this because I've had email going back and forth. He's a college student, president of a college a radio club in Indiana. And we're going to do a show sooner or later. And I'm trying desperately to not make him the spokesman for youth in amateur radio. But there's really going to be no way to avoid that. And he came up with a family conflict. He came up with a family conflict tonight, or he would have been able to join us and put in the youth perspective. So Tony, sorry. We'll try again.
Get him on sooner or later, I think.
Yeah,
sooner than later.
I consider myself part of the Peter Pan syndrome. I absolutely refuse to ever grow up.
Yeah, and almost no one is believing you are paying attention to that out there. But that brings me to a point that was not on our rundown here, but Bill, you can address this. Speaking of young hams, no young ham of the year this year. What's the story?
Very simple. I'm not a judge. I don't take any part in it. When we first started way back when, 25, 20, I was one of the two judges, the other being Bert Hicks, former WB6MQV, because we ran the thing ourselves. But since the committee was formed, 18 years ago or so, all I do is I get the stuff. Most of it comes by email. And I just reroute it to the committee. And what happened this year, and I could tell with the mail that was coming in, there were really no, I'll use the word viable, I don't know what other term, nominations. There were two or three, but more of this was, and I understand the league and other other youth-oriented award programs. I'll to paraphrase. Hi, my 7-year-old just got her technician license. Give them a radio. And literally, we get those. And we got a lot of those. Not a lot of them. We got some this year. But there were really no viable nominations to judge against. So Mark Abramovich and the committee, Mark NT3V, they made the decision that there was no way to judge this year, and so they elected to not give the award. That's their prerogative. And from a personal standpoint, it was very hard for me to swallow, you might say, or handle, because that's been something that's been very close to my heart ever since I was, early college days. And there's a whole long story. I'm not going to do it now. It's been published in World Radio as to why and how the award came about. But it's sad when you don't get, it's not the nominee's fault. It's the people who should be out there making the nominations, the hams out there. And they just didn't, I don't know if they didn't care. I don't know if it's laziness. I can't give you an answer on that. But we just didn't get, according to Mark, we just didn't get the a good cross-section of nominees to judge an award against. So that's the story. We are hoping, and Mark suggested this, we just held our board of directors meeting, and we're going to be doing some of our own outreach, public service announcements, and more advertising in magazines, what have you, on, you know, flyers, maybe it's a radio call. I don't know. It's they're working on it. I've got enough going here. So, but it's it was very, to me, I won't use the word traumatic, but it was very disappointing to me.
I appreciate you not dancing around the issue and answering it real directly, because you could have, you know, spun it around quite a bit. I have interviewed the past 2 years worth of young hams at and you give the award at the Huntsville Ham Fest.
Huntsville Ham Fest, yes.
Yeah, and I've interviewed them, and they have been absolutely outstanding examples of young ham operators. Very dedicated, interesting people that have dug into ham radio and done important things, probably not even with the caveat of for their age, done important things, and had looks like pretty bright futures. Over the years that you've been doing this, what kind of candidates have you seen? Have there been plenty of people to choose from most years, and this is unusual, or is it always one really stands out, but you're not getting a really good representative sample of what youth we really have out there?
Actually, I really don't know the answer to that question.
Because you're not the judge.
No, I'm not the judge, and I kind of recuse myself. I love that word, recuse. I try not to look at the nominating forms that come in either by mail or by electronically. I would have to say the past 2 or 3 years, most of 90% have been electronic, which tells you where the world of postage is going, postal world is going. But I try and sort out the non-nominations, as I described earlier, you know, give my kid a radio type thing, from the real nominations. And I just do a very cursory glance. And I'll be honest, we probably get anywhere between a dozen and 20 or so that are really what I use the word viable. Nominations that have an obvious click to them and that have meaning to them. Those are the ones that, and as they come in, they go to the committee. There's just, you know, I don't want to sit sitting on my computer, so I just put them in my backup drive, and they've gone out to the committee already, so it's they do it, and I hope my dog isn't bothering you.
I can hear him in the background, but yeah, he's just
that's,
cute.
That's Presley. He's a Jack Russell. And, you know, at the winners that the committee has chosen, and this goes back to the original committee that was chaired by Captain Larry Zetlock, KN4AQ, I think it was. And we've had the committee now for many years. The upshot is they have had some extremely interesting winners. And if you look back on the careers that have developed from some of these winners, for example, Sean Wakefield, who was our first winner, or recipient is a better word. I hate the word winner. But Sean has his own software development business out in Oklahoma. I mean, so a lot of these have gone on. And then there's one or two who have just disappeared from ham radio. That happens. You know, they lose interest. But most of them have gone into careers in anything from engineering and technology to law to you name it. I mean, I try and keep up as well as I can, and it amazes me. And Mark and I talk about this. It amazes me that these people who are winners of our award or recipients of our award seem to be become the leaders. For example, Brian Moloshevsky, I pronounced it there, I forgot. Brian, who's on the board of directors, he's a director from Moloshevsky, that's right. Brian Moloshevsky is a director on the ARO for the Rocky Mountain Division. I'm trying to remember Mary Alestra, who was only 12 when she got the award, is now a very well-known attorney in New York City. I mean, you look at the kid; these were kids or teens, you know. Mary was probably, I think, one of the youngest at 12. And look at the careers that they've gone on to. These were the, you know, the real doers, and we're proud of all of them.
Seems to indicate that when you guys made your choice of who was going to be nominated and who won, you made a good choice. That you're looking at people that showed a lot of potential. So it's disappointing that there's no award given this year. I am hoping that there's more than one person watching, kicking themselves right now for saying, why didn't I nominate the young person that I know? Not on the basis of give my kid a radio, but on the basis of, well, they've done some impressive things. What kinds of things do you look for when you were judging, or what kind of things would you look for in somebody showing this kind of potential? We may be setting the bar too high, in someone saying, well, I'm pretty sure they're going to be a future Supreme Court judge. I think I'll nominate him for Young Ham of the Year. That's a pretty high bar.
Yeah, and that's not a realistic bar. No, we look for accomplishment. In any area, you know, it can be scientific research, it could be public service.
What's your age limit? What's the top age?
It was 18. We moved it to 19. We thought that might help generate some more, but it didn't.
Okay, well, that's going to be high school to maybe freshman college, sophomore college.
That, you know, that,
or for prodigies, always, PhD candidates.
Yeah. That's always been our age group, and that's where the start is, 18 as a cutoff. But seeing and looking at, it's very interesting. If you look at a lot of the awards scholarships being given away nowadays, they're not going to as much to people who are graduating high school as they are to people who are actually looking towards graduate degrees. And it's fascinating to look at the pictures and see some of these old guys, you know, I can only put it be getting scholarships, and that surprised me. It really did. But now it's a changed world, you know. And you know, it's like I was hoping very much to see something out of the maker and hacker community, because there are a lot of hams in there, but they don't seem to be taking to the main line of ham radio, and definitely not towards ham radio awards.
Yeah, I'd like to talk about makers and hackers too, but that will be a subject for another program because we're closing in on time. Ward, have you got anything you want to toss in on this young ham subject? You consider this number two in importance.
I consider it number one in importance, actually. The outreach that we need to be engaged in across the hobby to not the just the traditional teenagers and students, but people in their 30s, people in their 40s, to bring them into the hobby. One of the ways to do that is through these awards, like Young Ham of the Year, to publicize that there are people out there doing interesting and useful things that are just getting started. I would try to publicize the award more, and that, hey, gee, we didn't get enough nominations. We know there's people out there, at Young Hams, that are certainly deserving of this award. I was thinking, I made some notes right here while Bill was talking. I thought, well, you know, there's a couple that I know. I'll have to nominate them next year. And I just didn't think of it. So we need to be having a full court press to outreach to these people, bring them in, let them do what they want to do in the hobby, not what we want them to do in the hobby, and let them do it and start getting out of the way, and to let them make the ham radio into what it's going to be for the next 100 years.
Yep.
Exactly, Ward. You hit it on the nose. And that's really what the whole thing was about when we started it, if you think about it.
Bill, you're making my camera switching hard.
I apologize.
You got to talk for 20 minutes minimum. All right, so let's move on. That subject deserves lots of attention, but I end up at board meetings at radio clubs that get off on that and spend an hour and really never get any place. So at least there's something here that you know you can do, which is to find that young ham near you and get him nominated. I know somebody that ought to have been nominated this year, and I didn't do it. The next on my list is this FCC enforcement. And earlier this year, the ARRL kind of wagged their finger at the FCC and said, come on, guys, get busy. And in enforcement and in getting rulemaking through. And then suddenly there's been a couple of pretty high-profile enforcement actions. Two fines have been levied, not collected yet. Michael Guernsey, KZ80, $22,000. Brian Crow, K3VR, $11,000. That's in the news, Bill. What's up?
Well, my answer to that is FCC... I think you're right, and I hate to use the word knee-jerk reaction, but it kind of comes across as that. In quotation marks now, well, if we issue a couple of fines or we take some enforcement action, maybe everybody else will fall in line. Fortunately, I cannot hear any of this here on the West Coast. It's all happening on the East Coast, and most of the people who are involved are East Coast or Midwest or something like that.
These particular two guys, the frequency they were involved in was 14313, which is sort of notorious. Mm-hmm. I don't pay that much attention. I have tuned across it now and then and said, yeah, that's kind of a zoo. And sort of have the philosophy that if we have one or two frequencies that contain all the zoo animals, then the rest of the band is relatively clear for the rest of us.
I'm sorry.
Ward, go ahead.
Oh, I said at least we know where they are.
Yeah.
One of the things that is missing right now, and we talked to Laura Smith about this, a couple of times, so when I would see her at forums and things like that, and say, you know, what's the deal here? People would ask in forums. He said, look, we're collecting evidence. There are strict rules about what we have to do. This is not something that we observe generally a person doing. They do it anonymously. We're not sure who these people are. We can't verify the tapes and stuff. So it's a long process. And this goes on and on. You see it all the time. It takes a long time to bring a federal case against anybody. It just does.
Why they call them a federal case.
Well, it's a federal case. It's a federal
regulatory
agency. And so there are certain evidentiary rules and procedures that you have to follow. But remember that the wheels of the law grind exceedingly fine and exceedingly slowly. So this could go on for a long time. How long did it take K1MAN to lose his license? 20 years? So anyway, one of the things that Riley Hollingsworth would do that I was completely in favor of, and I thought certainly took a lot of the steam out of, say, 75 meters, is he would get on 75 meters. He would go get on the air and talk to some of these guys and say, hey, you know, this is kind of inappropriate. Why don't you guys sort of back down a little bit? Why don't you take it off the air? Let's get along here. Just not so much getting on with threats of enforcement and all this kind of stuff, but simply to get on, show that the cop on the beat was out there and walking around the block and helping people get along and helping the troublemakers make better decisions about what to do with their time. If we had that kind of representation on the air, I think we'd have much fewer problems. The threat of this big regulatory legalistic hammer coming down is certainly satisfying to those who felt the lash of these guys, but I don't think it's really going to solve the problem. It's a people problem, and we're going to have to address it with people, not so much with writs of attorney and threats of forfeiture.
One of Riley's suggestions for the rest of us, not so much for the people that were causing the problem, but the people that were getting very consternated about it, was grab the tuning dial. There's wait a minute. Yes.
Big on your radio.
He made that talk at Dayton, and he was very funny. And if you want to see it, just go to hamradionow.tv and do a search for One Big Knob.
This is just about a 40-year-old QST article, or QST magazine. Next to the last page is a big presentation on Swan equipment. How many of you remember Swan transceivers? Boy, they were the latest and greatest, weren't they? The Swan 500 and the Swan 50, well, let's take the 350. It has 12 little knobs and one big knob. So does the 500, and so does the 250. So then take this QST magazine about 40 years later. Let's look on the back. TS-570, it's got 46 little knobs, one big knob. And you look in the last page there, there's the 2000. And I remember last year I heard a guy behind me when I was looking at it saying, that's so big and pretty, I couldn't get that in the house unnoticed. I thought that was a good remark. By the way, if you ever hear that I'm dead, race to Gettysburg to my house, because every piece of equipment in my house cost about $150. You can get some good deals. But this FT-2000, this FT-2000 has 75 little knobs, but it's still got one big knob right here. There's a reason for that, and there's a reason that you have thousands of frequencies.
You got to have a sense of humor to be in that job and deal with ham radio, and especially the miscreants. We certainly have our characters, and I thought it was great that he went out there and put a public face on the FCC, and a reasonable guy, not a threatening guy, not a guy who was excessively legalistic or anything. He was just a guy. So not this is ridiculous.
He was one of us, is what you're saying.
Yeah, he's one of us. Just, hey, yeah. Let's knock it off, you know. And that's all it really took for a lot of that stuff to kind of go away.
So, Bill, it sounds like you're saying that this may be a little bit of window dressing right now, and you know, it's going to be a show for now, and then maybe not
going
on.
I've seen this before. Remember, I've been licensed since '59, and with the exception of the era, I use the era because it was about 10 years. That Riley Hollingsworth's. And I wish he could have been here with us tonight, was handling enforcement. It's been always by the book. And, you know, it's, and by the book doesn't always work when it's an interpersonal situation. And that's what a lot of these things are. I can only judge by what I hear here in Southern California. And I don't hear a lot of the stuff from back east. I'll hear some of the stuff on 75 and 40. And of course, on one or more local repeaters, but you know, during Hollingsworth's tenure, most of the problems, except maybe one, two, or three high profile, almost everything disappeared. And once he retired, it started to grow again. So what this makes me believe is that Riley Hollingsworth's approach as being a friend and wanting to help is far more favorable and far more effective than just sending out a fine. And the other thing and we were talking about it before we started, was all these fines go out, or these NALs, Notice of Apparent Liability to Monetary Forfeiture. I mean, we were always reporting on, especially the pirate broadcasters, we're never able to find out if any of these were ever collected. You know,
to be a matter of public record.
Yeah. Well, where? Because what happens is the FCC, when they're not paid, turns it over to the Department of Justice. Department of Justice has the discretion to proceed or not proceed. But where do you find this information? I've tried. I've sat on the internet for hours, and I can't find it. Hmm. You know, it may be there. I'm not saying it's not there. But I suspect, and this is a suspicion on my part, at least dealing with unlicensed radio operators in the broadcast operators, mostly FM stations, is that they just disappear into the woodwork. And
well, if they've gone to court, there has to be a resolution. It could be a settlement, I suppose. And
you know, well, most of these never get to court. Most of these, especially with the pirate broadcasters, they just never respond. And so what happens is the NAL is affirmed into a fine, and then the fine, collection gets eventually turned over to the DOJ, and there subsequently, if the DOJ is going to go ahead, and I think this is the right way it works, it goes to the U.S. Marshals Service. But I haven't heard of any time that the U.S. Marshals have gone out to collect a $8,000 or $10,000 fine from a pirate broadcaster. Have you?
Ward, have you ever come across any resolution? It occurs to me, yeah, I never have.
No, basically, there's these big
exactly.
Things. Yeah. And then everybody goes, yay, for our side. And maybe the guy goes away, maybe he doesn't. And everybody feels better. And then it just kind of, you know, fizzles off into the distance, but
into the ether.
Yeah, into the ether. That's
about the only step two that I recall hearing fairly frequently is that the amount of the fine was reduced because somebody pled poverty. You still don't hear the next step.
And they agreed never to do it again. Yeah. You know, I'm really sorry. I'll pay you this nominal fee and let's call it a day. I'll forfeit my license or, you know, whatever. By the time you got to go through all that, it's a large expenditure of resources for a very small gain. So basically, we're a hobby of volunteers, and as anybody who's ever managed volunteers knows, you really don't have much of a lever over the volunteers to make them do or not do whatever it is that you do or not want them to do. So it's a personal thing. You have to convince them not to be buttheads in the first place. rather than try to cure the problem after they're misbehaving on the air. So it's a personal touch, and it's a personal touch not only from Riley but from all of us to help people make better decisions.
Maybe we can get Riley to come on the program sometime and give us some of that background. I think the hams would like to know.
Stories, don't you?
I'm not sure he can tell any of them, but I'll bet he's got some. This is kind of a public forum here. As public as I'd like it to be. I'd like it to be public to about, like 5 or 10,000 more people than it's public to. But
I wish we could do it live and take call-ins.
We're working on that. At some point we will.
That would be nice.
It's not call-ins anymore, it's chat rooms. They tend to get infected. So
that's why I stay away from chat rooms.
Yeah, I'm not sure that would be such a great idea. All right, well, put that issue to rest at least for now until something new comes up on it. And take a look at this. Recognize that little QST article?
Yep.
Right.
Yeah, and here, a word I'm going to doubly reemphasize that you are not speaking for the ARRL, that anything that you say about this issue, this public service versus emergency issue, is your own opinion, and you may decide not to issue any of that at all, and I would understand. So,
just give me a forum, I'll talk.
Okay, here's the forum. This is from, I think it was the June issue of QST, maybe before that. And Mike Corey put out an article in the public service column. If I could reduce it to its essence, it is we want to change. As I read it on the surface anyway, want to change the nomenclature, want to change the names of things, and refer less to the idea that ham radio participates in emergency communications and more to the idea that ham radio participates in public service communications, and emergencies would fall somewhere in that bailiwick. And he had some reasons for doing that. He had some statistics saying that far more of what we do is public service and very little of what we do is actual emergency. Although if you were to weigh the importance of those, suddenly the emergency stuff, even though it's not so much, gets really emphasized in value on a number of scales. Value in just purely what we do and value in the publicity and the public awareness of what we do. I mean, you guys have participated in public forums and listened to what newsmakers have said and what the general public says about ham radio. And the first thing anybody says about ham radio who's not already a ham is emergencies. They're the guys who handle our emergencies. So it's clearly important.
First thing they say is, are you still doing that?
Well, yeah, that's true. And then they say, my grandpa used to had a whole
Walter out in the barn, with the with the suspenders.
Yep, hear that all the time. You guys have maybe seen some pictures of my mobile. It's pretty elaborate. There's 8 antennas on there. I cannot pull into a gas station without doing the ham radio publicity thing. So I'm the rolling public relations machine for ham radio. I'm not sure that that's particularly good considering what my mobile looks like. But
Gary, do you remember the late I'm trying to remember. He said that ham radio operators are people who the public views as being in their basements with horn-rimmed glasses, spending their entire life getting the complexion of a fish.
That does not sound familiar to me, so I haven't heard the quote or who it was.
Gene Shepard, K2ORS, at Dayton.
Oh, okay, yeah.
That's where I first heard that.
Yeah, Ward, does it sound familiar to you?
Well, not in so many words, but I can understand it.
That's I'm looking right. to my complexion on the video here. And
kind of look, I've got a really good tan here. I get out. Yeah. Well, it's a farmer tan, but
And this is
summertime. And I live in Southern California, so you can't help it.
No excuse. Yeah, my wife and I will go to the beach, and then we'll check the NASA channel to see if anything has been reported from the space station. Amazing white objects on the Carolina beach. We're blinded up here.
well, you know, we got to get out and do some of that ARDF more.
Sunscreen is my friend.
But to address the issue, I'll jump in there and give my personal opinion. And I've been involved with ARES for, at least 25 years, and was involved in creating a very intense community ARES and emergency response group on Vashon Island, Washington, which is a real island, and it's surrounded by water. And if bad things happen in Western Washington, it's going to be very isolated. So it was very necessary for us to organize and organize effectively. So I dealt with served agencies up and down the ladder, everything from local to very large counties and a little bit of the state. And so I don't undervalue emergency communications. I think it's a very important part of what we do. It's one of the basis and purpose elements in 97.1. As a matter of fact, it's the first one. I'm not sure that means anything, but it's the first thing you see. But there are also four other reasons that we get our spectrum, and those involve the communications and operational arts and other things. And I got to say that the last 20 years, ever since this When All Else Fails campaign started, we've become excessively narrowly focused on that. It's become a one-note piano that we play over and over and over again. And it makes us feel good, and it sells stuff, and it has this cool little graphic with the Dennis the Menace tornado and all this kind of stuff on it. And it makes us feel important, and we do important things, but it's too narrow, and it's too focused. And I got to say, it really aggravates our served agencies when we show up waving these When All Else Fails flags as if we're somehow the pros from Dover, and we're going to show them how to really do it. And there's too much of that within the emergency response community and amateur radio, and it's not doing us any good. I think it's important. I think it's a very key element of what we do, and every ham should be involved to some degree with an awareness of emergency and disaster response communications and public service on some level. But I think we need to broaden our message. And my message has been very simple: science, service, skill. Those are the three things we do. In some aspect, you either do science or you do service or you do skill, and you can put those in any order that you want. But the idea that the amateur service is all about when all else fails is just far too narrow. And I think it discounts the other things that we do. And I would like to see it more balanced. I'm not saying de-emphasized, I'm saying more balanced message. And so I am more or less in favor of a realignment of our message away from strictly, we do MCOM, and we save the day and all this other stuff. Whereas, frankly, most of the time you see us, we're not. Operating, we're doing parades, we're doing sports, all these different things, or we're playing in our basement getting the complexion of a fish. All of these things have value, and all of these things relate to the amateur service as it has been since 1934's Communications Act. And I would like to see us recognize that we're a big, broad service and not keep hitting this one note on the piano, dang, 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 until it drives everybody nuts.
Well, it may drive some of us nuts. It may drive some of our competitors in the communications field. I kind of wonder what Verizon thinks when they hear us say, the cell phone towers are the first things to go, and those hardworking Verizon.
I don't think Verizon really knows where we exist, frankly.
Well, I mean, there's hams at Verizon and there's engineers, and they probably have some heartburn when we say the cell phone towers are the first things to go.
Yes, because they are in a commercial business. They cannot effectively build a communication system for commercial use that can handle more than a few percent of the subscribers at any one time. It's not economically viable.
I think the number is 9%, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, and that's high. It's typically 5 to 10%, something like that. Even the landline systems would go down when more than a certain fraction of the users picked up the phone after the earthquake. Everybody, did you feel that? And you wouldn't get dialed. It happens all the time.
It happened around here when we had a quarter inch of ice one time and people were late getting home from work and the cell system was overloaded.
It's not a technology question. Sure, they could build a system out there that could handle 100% of the subscribers, meet the seismic codes, meet this, meet that, and it would cost a fortune. Okay, they can't do that. They just can't do that. So it's unrealistic of us to go out and denigrate them for their system behaving in a perfectly predictable way.
But I've been the guy that went to the newspaper or the TV station and was working on selling the ham radio story. And the most successful times that I've had to do that are at Field Day, which is our biggest PR push of the year, just in general, and down here in North Carolina when there's a hurricane on the way. And either case, the story that sells is our emergency capabilities. And I'll try to add some of the rest of the story, and that gets edited out. So sort of after a while, you stop beating your head over the over the attempt to sell the rest of the story and say, okay, you want to hear about emergencies? Have I got a story for you?
Right. But the story that we tell is a personal story. And I think our neighbors and our community, and like we get back to this topic, a couple of topics ago about personal representation, what we do to our representatives and things. Certainly, emergency communications is an important part of the conversation, but it's not the only part. And what else do you do? Well, maybe it doesn't make the news, but it is part of your community conversations. And the idea of the three elements of science service skill, or if you look at the ARL's website with the five pillars, were broader than just emergency communications. And I think that needs to be sort of where we come from, even though on the TV news, maybe emergency communications is the primary thing that sells in that particular milieu.
Gary, if I may interject, which I always do.
I think that's why you're here, Bill.
Yes, I'm the professional interjector. The other thing that we've not brought up is human nature, ego. And there, I would suspect, and this is a guess on my part, that a lot of the new hams who are coming in who have only one interest, emergency communications, for whatever reason, maybe their job, whatever, they are driven either by ego or by other things, but they have no interest in the hobby. I've run into loads of people like this. They don't interact with radio clubs. They don't interact, go to conventions. All they do is show up once a month or once every week or whatever on a given frequency, usually on a VHF repeater, hold a drill, and you never hear them again. They're gone. So, that's another thing. And what are they driven by? They're either driven by ego. They're driven, you take away their rationale for being hams, for getting their license, and they'll disappear. So, it's... That's a double-edged sword.
Do you think those folks would have a real problem with a de-emphasis of the language of emergencies into public service?
This is my guess, okay? But I suspect that if emergency communications as a term, which is the term that they got involved in the hobby under, were to be de-emphasized, I think they'd walk. A lot of them would walk. I don't know how many. But you got to remember that for most, or if not all, but for most, this is their amateur radio station right here. That's it. They have no other commitment monetarily, something like this. And, what we used to call a shack on a belt, if you remember that term not long ago. But I've run into more and more people whose only interest in amateur radio is emergency communications. And they were brought in, and most of this, by the way, is since 9/11. You got the emphasis on, the heavy emphasis on amateur radio becoming almost a first responder, although we shouldn't be called that. But
we shouldn't be called that.
Yeah, but a lot of people I've run into, and you know, I'm in a different genre because I'm doing news, believe that that's their only purpose, is to be a, quote, first responder, have their little chat, have their weekly drill, and they're not involved in the amateur community. And I'm sure you've noticed that down where you live. I've noticed it in other parts of the country where I've been, there is a significant portion of the amateur radio community that is strictly MCOM oriented. And how do you tell these people you're no longer the most important part of ham radio? Because I suspect, I can't prove it, that many would just walk away.
And that sort of goes to the point I was going to ask next. I've been positioning this as a language change. Is the language change changing the reality? Is it going to change resources or emphasis on what people are actually doing? Or are we just shifting the labels around a little bit?
I think it's a matter of semantics. I think the ARL says, well, since hams are doing more public service, we will emphasize their public service aspect, which is fine. But they're not taking into consideration the people themselves who say, no, we're emergency communicators. So, look what we do. We meet every week. We practice for that emergency, which may never come, you know. But that's their reason for being in it, that term, emergency communications. And I've seen, and you only have to go to YouTube to see this, I've seen this carried to the extreme with cars with light bulbs and revolving lights and stuff. And these people really, there are a significant number, apparently, who believe that their only purpose is to be emergency communicators, that ham radio has no other purpose in their life.
Yeah, there's a line in there that I worry about, that what they really want to be is an emergency management employee, fire and rescue or something, and they, for some reason, can't get there, so they go into ham radio and put lights on their cars and stuff.
They live an imaginary life is what they do.
I know we all know one or two people like that. They kind of get their kicks from playing emergency responder. But I think the vast majority of the emergency communications people are solid, reasonable people that are interested in providing a service for their communities. And I think by taking emergency communications off the pedestal as the be-all and the end-all, you'll probably lose some people. But I don't think it's going to go away. I think broadening it to public service while still honoring and promoting emergency communication is going to be useful. And remember, Bill, you've been in this since 1959. You've seen these waves of people come into radio. There was, I think, the big one that when I got involved in the early 70s was the repeaters, you know, and the FM guys. And that all that they did was mess around with Motorola tube strips and hook them up. And
guilty,
you know, a T80, 80D, and then a T33. And that's all that they did. And that was their purpose in life. And then there was the packet radio guys. And then there was the people that got into ham radio because it was a convenient replacement for cellular phones. And so there was that wave of people that got their license and moved on through. And now we have this other batch that's come in primarily through this door marked public service emergency communications. And I think that's valid. It's very useful, but it's not the only thing. And if we continue to rely on this one and only thing, then it too will eventually sort of de-emphasize itself. And then what? We have to keep all of our doors open There's a heavy technical component to amateur radio, and there's simply an enjoyable operative skill part of amateur radio that's in there too. So we need to rebalance a little bit, and if we have to drop the MCOM down a peg or two, I'm not saying take it out completely. I'm just saying don't make it the be-all and the end-all of the service. I think we'll do fine, and I think that by opening more doors and reaching out to more aspects, more elements in the communities that are close to amateur radio, like the makers in particular, and all these other activities like geocachers and off-roaders and hang gliders and all these other, you know, amateur astronomers, for crying out loud, you know, all these other nearby communities, I think we'll be far better off as a broader-based community than if we put all our eggs in this one basket. And there's going to be some areas like down in the southeast, I think, where MCOM needs to continue to be a primary part of our message. It's important. And every year they get involved and they need to be recognized for what they do. But that's not every ham everywhere.
So, well, if it was, then you wouldn't have contests. You wouldn't have DX, and you'd have everybody just living for emergency communications. And let's be honest. The actual hard sell emergency, the really big emergencies, are few and far between.
Thank goodness. Yeah, I mean, I've
you're right. Down here, though, in the southeast, not as far between as we'd like.
Yeah, that's true. I prepared a presentation. I did not get to give it because I could not go to the centennial. And it will be distributed somehow. I'm not exactly sure what format.
I have an idea. Television show.
Ah, there you go. Okay. Well, it's called Recruit, Train, Retain, and it is about continually circulating people through the hobby, through all these other things, and they come through one door, maybe it's emergency communications. I mean, you go to breakfast for a couple of years, you know, on Saturday, and you do the drills, and you hang around with the team, and after a couple of years, unless you're really motivated, unless there's been a severe weather or a disaster or something, you kind of tend to leave the handheld in the drawer, and what else is out there? Am I going to renew my license when it's up? You need to be able to recruit within the hobby across party lines here and start to train people so that they learn that there's more to ham radio than just whatever it was that they thought they were going to do when they came, whether it's MCOM or whatever.
We do tend to be niche. Some of us are very generalists. You're an example of a broad generalist because you got your fingers in pies all over the place. But a lot of us, we find a niche and sometimes we'll move from one to the other. You know, I was one of those repeater guys for a long, long time. And that's where I hung my hat. It sounds, Ward, like that you're seeing not just a label change. You would like to see an actual change in
attitude,
where resources get placed and where the conversation goes.
It's part of this outreach effort that is so critical to the survival of amateur radio. I don't think we can afford to just do one message. I think we have to have a broad-based outreach, not only outreach outside the hobby, but outreach within the hobby to strengthen the ability of hams and to strengthen the robustness of the community.
Bill, you were going to say something?
Yeah, I was going to say that one of the things that's been tried, we tried it, and I think the league also tried it, was mentoring programs where people who are hams, especially retirees and things like that, would offer their services to newer recruits, newer hams, or hams that wanted to change their interests. And for some reason, neither our program, the league's just kind of disappeared. Our program still exists through QCWA, but very rarely do we hear anything about it. All the information is on our website. I think QCWA has it. We'll mention it in the newscast, but it's very, very rare that somebody will say, "Hey, I want to learn about packet radio, or I want to learn about this or that." It seems that people, when they get into the hobby, get, as you use the term, niche. They get into this niche, they want to stay there because there's one other aspect. Their friends are there, you know. So if they get in as repeater people, let's say, and we put, yeah, if you notice something, For about the past 20 years, we seem to put labels on everybody. He's a repeater person. He's a GXer. We're TV guys, okay? But we tend to put labels on everybody, which wasn't there when I got into the hobby in 59, 60. We were hams. We were just, you know, whatever license class we were, whatever our interest was. In my case, the day I got on 6 meter AM, I called my first CQ with a home-built piece of garbage transmitter built out of old radios, and I worked Florida. And from Brooklyn, New York to Florida on 6 watts peak, using a 50-foot piece of wire as the receive and transmit. To me, that was amazing, and that kept me on 6 meters ever since 1959. There's not been a day when I haven't at least monitored the band and see what I could work.
And detect the strong possibility of going down the rabbit hole of nostalgia here, Bill. We're running out of time.
Yes, and I'm not going to, but I'm just giving you an idea. We all have, you know, we all have our interests. Then mine went to emergency communications for a while, then back to building and things like that. But it was a different time and a different era. And I think that makes a show in itself.
It does. I want to toss in two quick things, one very quick and one a little longer. This is a little bit longer one. The current and probably about to be replaced issue of CQ, Rich Moseson's editorial takes the ARL very much, if I can find it, there we go, very much to task at this idea. He writes quite a bit about it, and it's got a lot of good points to make, and I won't make them for him, but I'll hopefully have him on the show at some point to make his own points about that. And after he listens to this, he may, and I'm sure he's gotten an earful. The League has gotten an earful, which reminds me there's one third point to make here, but the one little one that I'll make is, and Bill, you may remember from your history, this occurred just a little bit before my time, but ARES wasn't the original name of the Emergency Communications Group. Do you remember what the original name was?
No, it was AREC, Amateur Radio Emergency Corps.
ARPSC, the Amateur Radio Public Service Corps.
That predates me then also.
Yeah. Well,
it was AREC when I got in.
Maybe the only reason I remember that is from reading all those old QSTs at my mentor's shack.
It's funny. I gotta throw this in. We're so interested in labeling each other as a this or a that, or I don't really understand those guys, or I don't really figure out what do they see in that part of the And it's funny. You get the slightest little bit outside amateur radio, like your spouse, okay, or your friends or neighbors. They don't see any of that. Okay, all they see is you're a ham radio operator. They don't know what you do. They don't know what you like to do. They don't know what your experience is. They don't care about your awards and all your other stuff. You're just a ham. And by labeling ourselves into all these little silos and niches and all these things, all we do is divide ourselves and weaken ourselves. If we're going to have this outreach, this public face, we need to stop breaking it down to the point where, I'm a this kind of a ham, or I'm a that kind of a ham. I'm a ham.
Amen. That's... Amen. Amen. I'll tell you 100. It's what I've been saying for ever since I started. We don't need labels. We don't have to be a DX or a con. We're a ham radio operator, and we're proud of who we are.
Right.
Bill, you did, however, pick something out of the ARL minutes. The league has gotten a lot of heat about this emergency thing. Most of the comments that you read online are, what the hell?
They're negative.
Where are you going? So you saw something in the board minutes that caught your attention.
Basically, it seems like the ARL, I hate to use the word backtracking, but the verbiage in this resolution that was passed was, it seems that it commits itself back to using the term emergency communications. Again, it's going to have to, as I said before when we were talking on the phone earlier today, that you really have to wait and see what these things mean, because it's a resolution from the board. But in reading it, and I read it again after we got off the phone, it appears to me that the league, and possibly because of its association with FEMA, just, you know, have to, again, we have to, it's going to take time to absorb all this, but it appears to me that the ARL is going to, again, start putting emphasis on the term emergency communications. But again, this came in, what, an hour before we started getting ready for this show. So
yeah, breaking news. It was
breaking news, and I, you know, so it'll be interesting. I want to sit on it for a couple days and see who I can contact and make sure that the interpretation is correct. But on the surface, that's what it appears to me. Ward, have you seen that?
I have not seen that particular thing. I saw another element of the minutes where the board has strongly endorsed efforts to outreach, and they're going to put in some more. They're going to put some muscle behind it. They're going to put some resources into this, and I think that's important. And I don't think there's any shame in an organization saying, gee, our message wasn't received, we've gotten some more input, maybe we need to recalibrate a little bit. Fine. It's the people that won't change in the face of any kind of discussion that are the problem. So if they want to change a little bit, and remember, I'm a they. I'm not part of the ARL. I'm something else. I work with them. So this is not policy. They want to change a little bit if they want to. Nobody said emergency communication is going away. If they need to readjust how they're going to balance the different parts of the message, oh, fine, do it. You know, whatever has to happen. Nobody said they were never going to say MCOM ever again. it just has to be part of the. We have to bring up some of the other elements of amateur radio along with it. That's all I want to see.
Yeah, I read this as a reaction from the board to the comments that they've been getting, just to say, no, emergencies are still important, and here's our resolution that say our emergency component is still very important.
But yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Not ready to change any policy or anything. So let's move on to something a little bit different. I mentioned before that we were all involved in public relations. I have been a PIO and a PIC, that's the state-level ARL official for public information. I'm not doing that anymore. Still, I have the title of a PIO, but I, you know, sort of more like a PIO emeritus, because I really don't have time to dig into the nitty-gritty. You know, when the hurricane's coming, I'm not the guy calling the TV stations anymore. Somebody else is doing that around this area, and they're doing a pretty good job. But I did that for 10 years or so.
And yeah, I worked at a TV station, and the ND news director would always come calling me. So,
because you were the ham, he knew.
I was the ham, and the ham to go. I was the go-to ham at KTTV.
Yeah.
So, if you were a previously identified emeritus PIO, you would be a PIEPIO.
EIEIO?
Yes, that's where, that's about where I was going to go.
I was working on that real hard there in the background.
Yes. I think I've finally fallen off of the Rolodexes from the TV stations. They're not calling me anymore, but they called me for a long, long time.
Point where it fell out of the Rolodex.
Yeah, and somebody else is in there. But I'm still interested in it, and I like to see the way our message is portrayed. And I'm also, you know, doing this show and other ham radio media and the stuff that you've been particularly interested, Bill, is the way we communicate to ourselves. You know, we are our media use, both internal and external, is a reflection on how very much we are stuck in the past. Other organizations, commensurate size and involvement in as amateur radio, have media outreach, and both external and internal, that is far more sophisticated than what we do. We're happy with our magazines. We're happy with our websites and our rather pathetic collection of YouTube videos. Just made a whole bunch of people happy with me.
Please don't get started.
Some are pretty good.
Some of them are pretty good, but I even got Steve. Okay, Ford. Steve Ford. Yeah.
WVBALIMY.
Yeah. And this is you know, 5 or 6 years ago, when the last serious documentary I produced. But you know, he was mentioning, comparing that video that was, I forget, it was the field day, last big field day, or maybe the digital voice. Yeah. But he was comparing it to the, his words, cringeworthy efforts that, you know, many of us put on YouTube. So I'm kind of interested in the stuff that we put out. And here is going to be an interesting example, because Sean Kutzko, KX9X, is the current media and public relations guy at ARRL. And he did an interview with the local radio station, WTIC, up in Hartford, in preparation for the convention. And it's it looks like it's 7 minutes and 44 seconds, so I'm not going to go through the whole thing. I think I have queued up, and I'm hope it's going to play here. There is the question. Anybody that's involved in a media interview gets the question. And the question, it won't be directly asked of him here, although I got a couple of other examples, is, what is amateur radio? And I'm going to put you guys on the spot in a moment for your elevator speech, what is amateur radio? You know, the 25 words or 30 seconds or less. But in a way, Sean got that question from the guy that he was talking to. And let me see if I can make this play.
All right. Now tell us, ARRL, where did, I mean, is it amateur radio or is it American radio? I've heard that back and forth both ways.
It's the American Radio Relay League.
And it's all about, you know, it's for amateur radio people, right? People that just love this business and they want to be ready to help out if a crisis strikes and a lot of other things. Tell us what you do.
Well, mostly what amateur radio is known for is setting up communications during disaster situations. A lot of folks remember Superstorm Sandy, that we didn't have power for about a week.
Sorry, Ward.
And we were instrumental in getting communications set up up and down the eastern seaboard while the storm was working its way up north. We've helped in Hurricane Katrina. We've helped with the Colorado flooding that occurred last year out in the Boulder County area in September of last year. That's what we're mainly known for, but it's also just a great way to learn hands-on about electronics, physics, weather, all kinds of other disciplines. It's a wonderfully educational hobby.
Well, how did it start, Henry?
So, he caught what you were looking for, Ward, toward the end there. What were those three things that you wanted to badge us with?
What? I mean, service skill.
Yeah.
It's just three punchy, easy to understand.
Alliterative.
Yeah. Boom, boom, boom. And then people ask you about it, and then you got a story to tell.
I'm going to write that down. Science, service, skill.
Or service, science, skill. You know, if you think public service is our most important thing, then say service, science, skill. It's five syllables. It just punches right through. The thing is, you know, you've got your elevator speech. So people say, well, what is this ham radio thing? I say, it's the most powerful communication service available to the private citizen on the planet Earth. And that usually gets their attention. They really have no idea. And so what do? And then you can just rattle off all this stuff. One of my favorite stories is what do you like to do? I say, I like to listen to the world turn.
Well, hang on for just a minute, because I want to play one more example. Sean is a very well-spoken media professional. I mean, he knows what he's doing. Most of us, when we get into that opportunity, it is not quite so cut and dried, and not quite so professional. So if he is at one end of the continuum, I'm going to play something, and I don't know whether this becomes the category of embarrassing someone or just saying, well, here's another side of the coin. You, as a, you know, the consumer of the video, as the watcher, you can decide what you think of this, but let me put it on. This is from a local cable operation, and it was presented to me, it's a county adjacent to the county that I live in. It was presented to me as, look, this is one of our local hams he got on cable TV, and he's showing the world what ham radio is all about. That's not the ham we're looking at. That's the interviewer on the program. So let me see if I can make this play, and we will see how this one worked out. If I can find the play button here.
My first question for tonight. Mr. Kellum, can you tell us what is ham radio, or what is the emergency radio, emergency, sir? What is that?
Hey, Ms. Godin, that's actually a two-part question. Ham radio is a group of people who come together to further a hobby. Ham radio is for communications, experimentation, education, and several other aspects of ham radio. The amateur radio emergency service is what we do for here in Johnston County. We provide emergency communications when all else fails. For example, when Fran came through in 1996, the very first thing that went down in Johnston County was their communication system. They called on the amateur radio community. We provided communications because at that time all else had failed.
All right.
Okay, so he hit all of your favorite points, Ward.
Well, you know, I mean, you pick any one of the 700,000 amateurs out of the pie, you know, and you pick them up and you dangle them in front of the camera and you say, okay, speak. They're going to say whatever it is that they see amateur radio is. And this guy's probably a participation in his local ARES group, and he thinks that's the most important thing. And so that's what he said.
Yeah, but he also covered everything else fairly nicely, I'd have to say.
Yeah. I mean, and he said, and there's all these other things that we do. But, you know, it wasn't exactly a very catchy speech, but he answered the question.
Yeah. By the way, he's Mike Kellum, KD4UJC, so I'll give him identification. And if you've never done this, if you've never had the unblinking eye of the camera pointed at you, and the reporter asking you questions, and you criticize someone who has, well, you don't know what you're talking about, because this is hard.
Oh, God, yeah.
Yeah, the first time, everybody remembers their first time, that if they're in broadcasting
and they cringe,
all.
Yeah.
Gosh, oh, yeah. How did I ever survive? Yeah, right. Yeah, and you know, ham radio is us. It's every one of us, wherever we are. We ought to be encouraged to think about it a little bit. We can't all be pros.
Yeah, I still remember one of the first times a segment producer from our news, and this goes back way back when we were Metro Media before the sale to News Corp 20th Century Fox. So we're going back probably to 1982, 1983. And there was a hurricane, don't ask me which one, and they were looking for information, and somebody in the newsroom said, hey, well, Bill's a ham, and he might be able to talk to somebody. Well, this is before we had the ham station, and I was just lucky enough to know who to call, and I'll tell you who it was, Gordon West, WB6NOA, and they sent a crew out to Gordon's house, and after that, I was the guy to go to, and for many years, Gordon was the person you would always see in any emergency would be Gordon on KTTV.
Well, Gordon certainly does make a memorable presentation.
Very much so. Very much so.
Yes. I mean, Gordon. My phrase for Gordon is lovable goofball. I'm not sure that would be his favorite phrase, but that's sort of the way I look at him. But I think when he's going to be on broadcast media, he probably sobers it up a little bit and makes him a little bit more straightforward pitch.
Oh, I've got some tapes here. I say tapes because they're VHS. And he comes across as the most knowledgeable person about amateur radio you could want to ever run into. I mean,
he is. I mean, he really
very
knows his stuff.
Straight line. Very much, but at the same time, extremely personable. And I think that's why the station really liked him.
Yeah. So one more that I want to point out, and this just showed up on QRZ.com today, and I looked at it. This is not the news media. This is not hams talking to the general public. This, in fact, this almost defies typical categorization because we don't see things like this very much. And I'm only going to play a couple of minutes of it. It is It's been nominated for it's been entered in a film festival up in Alaska by the creator, and that's Corliss Kimmel, AL1G. And you'll see her in the program, and I will say a little bit more about it after I play just a little bit of it. It's I think about 16 minutes long, so we'll just play a little bit. And watch some of these images carefully, because they're kind of important in the story. And this is a story. Groom, the bride. That's Corliss. It's going to help in understanding this program if you know Morse code. In fact, if you don't know Morse code, you're not going to get it at all. He's just calling CQ. CQ, CQ, AL1G. And you probably get the idea that she is in some distress. But it's subtle. And she's not beating you over the head with it. So that's pretty much all I'm going to play. In fact, it just went away anyway on me. Go to QRZ.com, and it's going to be one of the top stories, even as you watch this a few days from now. And if you don't see it there, just Google CQ in my dreams, CQ in my dreams, and maybe toss in the call sign AL1G, and you'll probably find it. As a video production, it had its flaws. It was not purely professional, especially for something that you think is going to be entered in a film festival. But I have to say that as I watched this through to the end, and I'm not going to do any spoilers as a story, I choked up. It got me. Have you guys seen ham radio production going this direction before?
Not I, and I've done a lot of it, as you know, and you've done a lot of it, but I've never seen, and what we'll call, I think this is what you call an emotional piece, and again, you have to see the whole thing, and when you do, it takes you back a little bit, but I don't want to spoil it, but it's well worth watching.
Yeah. Corliss lost her husband several years ago, Frank, and they are the parents of Chris KL9A, who was one of the winning operators for WRTC. I know Chris well, and it's very interesting story, and it shows an emotional side of amateur radio that you don't often see. Occasionally, you'll see something out of the ordinary. A lot of ham stuff tends to be documentary style, training film style, that kind of thing.
Promotional.
Yeah, promotional. Well, or instructional. I'll put it that way.
I'll go a step further and say that about 98% of what I see is cheerleading, and some of it's done well, and some of it's really really bad.
Cheerleading, or it's about us, what we do, yeah. Not so much who we are, and this is more of a who we are kind of a piece. And there's a couple in Denmark, Andrew and Lissa, who are known as the Ham Band, and they do some
very good friends of mine for many years. Yeah,
songs, and they're not all funny lyrics. I mean, I like to do funny lyrics and things like that, but it's not really an emotional piece. I've written some fictional stuff and some things, even poetry about ham radio, but it's very, very unusual, and most of the people that get into the hobby are technically oriented or functionally oriented, and it's not really an emotional thing for most people. Although they may have an emotional relationship with it themselves, it doesn't come to the fore very often, and it's not really encouraged.
Yeah, like I say, I haven't seen anything produced like that before myself. So
well, this seems to be a first. Maybe it'll start a trend. I don't know.
Yeah, I can see it getting entered in the ARL video contest if they run it for this year. Yeah. And I don't know that, you know, we could probably use more stories like that. It's not promotional in the least. It's not anything that you would say get into ham radio for.
No, it comes from the heart. It's somebody's heart and the soul. She's expressing her feelings, and that's what a good story should do. She's telling a story, doing it without words, doing it just with music and Morse, and yet you know exactly where she's coming from and where the whole thing is headed.
You do if you know Morse code, because there's no subtitles.
No, yeah. I think it was very well done the way it was.
Ham radio's first foreign language film, yeah. It's like fishing. You get guys that go out fishing, and there's a lot of how-tos and magazines and all this stuff. But there's a lot of poetry in it, and stories and songs and emotionally rich media pieces, for lack of a better word, material about what fishing is to a human being. And we need more of this, what is amateur radio to a human being aspect of how we tell our story. We can't just talk about it in terms of hardware and signal strengths and the things that we say and our cue signals and all that kind of stuff. It's why do we do this? It's because we have an emotional relationship with it that makes us a lifetime ham. And that part of it is just... it's almost assumed, but it's not really put out there for other people to experience.
Go ahead, Bill.
Have either of you seen the online version of a book called The World's Greatest Hobby? Dave Bell, W6AQ, who we all know, wrote this, and it's online. It's World's Best Hobby, I believe, is the title of it. Hobby.
Head down.
And it's the story of Dave's life, literally, how he got into ham radio and how that also affected his career. Very, very fascinating book. I was one of the people helping him edit it. And I found out, Dave's been a friend of mine for 40 some odd years, and I found out so many interesting things about him. But it does come from an emotional point of view, and I'm very impressed by it. I believe he's going to have an audio version of it also, so. But it's worldsbesthobby.com or just Google World's Best Hobby Dave Bell, and I'm sure it's going to pop up.
Yeah, I'm trying that, and it has
popped
up.
There you go. That's it. That's the book. And there's, I think, 26 or 27 chapters, and I did some of the photography for it and some of the... Dave and I were both writing books. I have a book similar that I've been working on for several years, and we edited each other. So. But this is a very, very well done piece. And this is the emotion, the real heart and soul of somebody whose life revolved around, to a great degree, amateur radio, the media, entertainment, and how they all came together. If you haven't read it, sit down and read it. Whether you do it online, whether you wait for the audio podcast, or whether you wait for the actual printed version. I have a printed version here, but it's just a one-off. It's a stapled together version. But it will be coming out sometime as a book. And
it is at theworldsbesthobby.com.
And if you want to just read it, just... put it in your computer, your Nook, or whatever you have. I just read it on this big screen because my eyes are old.
And I'm very pleased to share a call sign suffix with Dave. It was a total coincidence.
Yeah.
We're both AQs, and we're in this media production. And in terms of most of his career, he's been a notch or three above. I was going to say I don't do professional stuff. I don't do it in ham radio. I am pleased that my fingers have touched both in audio and video material that is seen nationwide on every network, every cable network, every broadcast network, frequently. So I work at that level professionally, but Dave is Hollywood, and I'm not Hollywood in commercials. So
he's a filmmaker. He's done some very well-known films, and Long Walk Home with Sissy Spacek, several others that come, you know, that just don't come to mind right now. But he spent his entire career, and he still is. He's still, you know, Dave is still making movies. So, he has. Don't expect to hear him go away, because he loves the business. We get together about once a month for lunch. So, he did make it to the ARO National.
I should have put him on the show. Yeah. Has he got Skype?
You know, I don't think so, but I can always go over with my laptop, because he's got Wi-Fi in his office, so I can just bring over mine. Yeah.
All right.
Bring this camera and my laptop. You know.
Okay, so Bill, is there anything coming up in Newsline that's going to surprise us this weekend?
Nothing. My one interesting story, which isn't, you know, there's not a lot of very heavy duty stories this week. One interesting one is revolves around the Maritime Mobile Services Net, which normally handles only emergencies at sea, but this just a couple days ago handled an emergency on land. An overturned truck in, of all places, outside Las Vegas, Nevada, in an area where there was absolutely no repeater or cell phone coverage. It's just a very fascinating piece. The other one that's interesting is from down under, from Australia. Australian hams are going to be forced for the next year and a half to share the 70-centimeter 450 band. On an equal secondary basis with business communications, as the Australian ACMA repackages the frequencies at above 400 megahertz. So that's going to be an interesting one to see where that goes.
Yeah, I was surprised to see something over the weekend. I was down at my in-laws, and they were having trouble with a remote temperature sensor. They had one of these remote things that sits outside, mm-hmm. and reads the temperature, and then it displays it on a little box inside the house, and it wasn't reading. And you know, we looked at the batteries, and they were corroded. Put new batteries in, cleaned it up. Didn't really help. But I was looking on the back of it, just looking for, you know, anything that would give me a clue as to where I might get some something to make this thing work. And on the back of it, it said operates in part 15 on 433.15, mm-hmm. right in the middle of a ham band.
Yeah, because part 15 devices are permitted in part of the 70-centimeter band.
So that let me grab my handy talkie and tune in. Although when I looked on the web and Wikipedia and stuff, turns out that stuff is very broadband, a couple hundred kilohertz wide, mm-hmm. And heard nothing. And so it helped me tell that, yeah, this little temperature sensor was not sending anything, even though we'd replaced the batteries and cleaned it up. So it was pretty dead.
Did you try percussive maintenance?
Of course. Yeah. Yeah. You know,
I love that.
Not the fine tuning hammer and then the bigger fine tuning hammer.
Sledge. Yeah.
The other thing, the other story that you were mentioning, the Maritime Service Net, that's the folks on 14.3, right?
14.300, they've been there for, 35 years now.
So. Yeah, interesting thing about them, 20 meters can be dead, absolutely dead. Tune across the band, and you hear things in two places. One of them is 14.3. You'll hear somebody running that net. And the other is 230, where the slow scan TV is.
Oh, yeah, you'll always hear something there.
Yeah, and if you don't hear anything there, just key up on sideband and go KN4AQ testing, and somebody will come up with a signal. That's probably
automated. And if you don't hear a response to that, you better go outside and look to see if the sun's still there.
Yeah. So, Ward, what have you got to tell people about before we wrap things up?
Well, let's see. We've just gotten another edition of the handbook out, and the question pool committee is working real hard on the general class license pool, and that's a volunteer committee. They don't really get a whole lot of strokes from people. There you go. There's the 2014 version. Very good.
In hardcover.
Hard.
And
the serial number? Yes. Ah, very good.
Because I have a chapter in it.
Yeah.
I can't reach mine. It's over here, but it's just out of reach, and I don't want to go bending over a camera.
Yeah, Ward knows I've got a chapter in it because he had to edit it. Poor guy.
Yeah, I'm always pestering you about it. We're working on brand new instruction manual and new websites and stuff, trying to make it easier for people to learn more things about the hobby and trying to help them upgrade into the higher classes and things like that. So that's what I'm focused on these days, and putting up some new antennas for W1AW Portable Missouri in October, and maybe I'll actually get to do some of this ham radio stuff instead of just writing
or talking about it.
Yeah.
And don't forget that the Ham Radio for Dummies book is sitting on the shelf just a little bit out of reach, so I'll stick this up and cover part of it up, so we'll just pretend this is Ham Radio for Dummies, because you've got that book out there as well.
Material. That's right. No subliminal material in this show.
That's okay. You deserve all the credit that you can get. Like I say, you are the Renaissance ham. Fingers in every pie.
It's a big hobby. Nobody knows, there's nobody out there anymore that knows all about everything. It's just too big.
All right. Let's wrap up this program. We should have coordinated this, but I think you guys know how the show ends. And I am Gary Pearce, KN4AQ. Bill, who are you?
I'm Bill Pasternack, WA6ITF.
And I'm Silver, N0 Alpha X-ray.
And back here, I have to mention very quickly, because by this
Arvin.
Time, nobody's still watching.
Yeah,
that's Arvin. It gives me the chance to put up the title at the bottom here that says, stop by the website, hamradionow.tv. If you thought that we gave you 2 hours of really valuable information, it's currently 2 hours and 18 minutes, of really valuable and entertaining stuff, help me pay the bills. These guys, they're not getting paid anything for doing this. It's totally volunteer activity. Me?
What? What?
That's right. Didn't you read the contract?
What contract?
Yep. For me, there's some expense in here. I got all the expensive cameras and stuff. You guys are using the cheap little webcams. So stop by hamradionow.tv and click on Arvin's icon and help us out if you can. The Kickstarter's still doing well, so no help needed over there. We'll see you in Austin in September. For now, for Ham Radio Now and Bill and Ward, I'm Gary Pearce, 73. Tell you what, I will say over. Bill, you say and. Ward, you say out. Over.
And
out.